produce under the name Phaeleh. Kind of known for making more sort of chill, dubstep, garagey sort of stuff. I don't really know what you'd call it. I think people kind of generally will know me for sort of my more vocal tunes, sort of especially the ones sort of featuring Sound Mouse, a track called Afterglow, and sort of done some other bits and bobs with Annika and Indycore and iMitri in the past. Hopefully today kind of give you an idea what sort of goes on when I make a tune. So we'll see what happens. Something that's really important to me when I'm making tunes is my effects settings. I generally like to have a lot of delays, a lot of reverbs and stuff. So whilst it might be a bit backwards, I'm just going to add a few effects channels to begin with. I'm going to start with a few delays or reverbs. I'll start with the reverbs. That's what I normally do. Now, I quite like sort of plate sounds, and I like having a little play with the EQ in the reverb. I've used R-verb for years. I generally use that or Glazeverb for my reverbs. Despite all the sort of settings normally having a sort of roll off on the high end, I like giving a little boost just to get a bit of sort of sparkle on it. Something else that I will always do on my effects settings is set up an EQ after them, because what I tend to do is put a lot of reverb and delay on my sounds. So a good way to avoid the sort of mix down getting muddy is by just sort of rolling off the high end and a little bit of the low end. So I'll typically do something like this. It's an EQ called Voxengo. I've just used it for years. By default comes up with a high pass and low pass for me, which saves me a little bit of time. Right, so there's a reverb. I just use a standard plate sound in the presets. Might have a little play and find something a bit better normally, but try and do this kind of quickly. Most important thing for me is some delays. I swear by a plugin called Own Boys, which my mate Fingers tipped me off about many years ago. So I'm still using this for all my delays. I love it because you can modulate all the parameters. What I kind of like doing is having delays that kind of will pan around or move around if there's a filter. Okay, so for my first delay, I'm going to set it up on 3/4 beat delay. So you get a nice sort of stud thing. This works really well in dubstep and garage. Rather than having something straight, you're getting sort of more of a syncopated beat that works really well. Now, in Own Boys, as I sort of previously said, the great thing is you can modulate parameters. So what I'll normally do is just apply a little bit of modulation on the frequency. I'll normally use a bandpass filter. Pan, I like that to pan about, move around, keep it interesting. It sounds kind of lazy, but I find if I can get the effects sense doing a lot of the work and a lot of movement, it kind of keeps people's ears interested. Whereas if you get very static sounds, nothing moves, I think people tend to get a bit bored a bit quicker with music. So again, with that, I will, just to stop any unwanted frequencies, just put a little low pass and roll off the low end as well, just so it doesn't get too messy. And the good thing with doing that as well, it means if you've got kind of fuzzier bass sounds, not just a sine wave, you can actually be sending that sound to your delays and reverbs and things. So you get a bit of texture from it, but it doesn't get muddy in the low end, which is where you'll end up with problems with mastering. Right, so I'm basically just going to add a couple more effect sends. Again, I'm going to use Own Boys again. This time I'm going to go for a beat and a half delay, so it's kind of double the length of the previous one. Again, I'm going to use a bandpass filter, move the frequency around a bit. Hopefully these will all sound all right when we actually test them. Again, it's just something that means that I can get a few sort of textural things going on. Again, I'm going to put an EQ on there, but I would definitely say sort of the way you set up your sends can help sort of define your sound a little bit. So feel free to experiment. What I might do now is set up another send with a reverb on, but then put a delay after it. You can play around with the order, the way you chain things. I think the thing is, the best thing with music is there's no rules really. So you can sort of read a lot of advice and get pointers, and you can take them on board when you want. But at the same time, you don't have to actually follow it by the book. So just have a little play around. So what I'm actually going to do, I'm going to put a delay after the reverb. Similar sort of settings as previously, sort of a beat and a half, some movement on the filter and the pan. Just hope that sounds right. So it's something that I might sometimes do, which is quite interesting for an effects end. I will set up, when I can find it, a little pitch shift. Now, this is my favourite pitch shifter. It's the one I first started using that sounded good. It's another Waves one called Sound Shifter. I'm sure there's probably some cheaper alternatives out there, but this one I just love. It sounds smooth. So what I've actually done there is I've just pitched it up an octave. So for this effects end, whilst it might sound a bit extreme, once we get some sounds in there, you'll see that if I send it to this, it helps add a bit of sparkle on top. So again, I'm going to put EQ on there just to tidy it up a bit. I'm sure that'll be all right. It's important not to get too lost in the sort of technicalities and little things. I just prefer making tunes rather than getting sort of lost in a science project or anything. Right, so I should probably start off by making some music. Some people like to start with beats, so maybe today we'll do that. So something I like to do with my music is layer stuff up, especially with the beats. So rather than just having one massive kick drum and snare and some hats, I like to have some quite small glitchy sounds. So something I'll do for this, I'll just load up a kit. This one will do. Doesn't really matter what it sounds like. Now what I like to do to get these glitchy hits is I will, for all the sounds, just pull the envelope right down so you get a really short, is this actually going to make any noise? So you can hear that rather than having the full samples, if you just pull the envelope down, I get a much shorter sound. What I'll then do is I'll just pitch them right up, doesn't matter how much. And we start having this much smaller sounding kit. Now I like to pull that down so it ends up being very glitchy. It's almost like the kind of hits you'll hear in the sort of music Paul makes, stuff like that. Now it can be a little bit extreme sometimes, but what I tend to do is lay down a very short, glitchy sort of loop, and then I'll layer something a bit heavier over the top just to emphasise the groove. So if I open up the editor on this one, something else worth mentioning is I can't remember the last time I did a tune where it just had a straight quantize. I normally like to put some swing on it, typically about 33%. If I'm doing something proper, old school garage guy sort of style, I'll put that up to 66. But we're going to work with 33. So what I might do is just get a basic pattern on the go. So I'm going to find some hits I like. That's quite a nice one. So what I'm actually going to do, now I'm sure a lot of people are used to a very sort of straight sounding beat. If I just make that loop shorter, that's a kind of standardy sort of beat you might find in a lot of things. To give it a bit of a sort of more garagey feel, it sounds a bit sort of lazy, but basically move your snares one block either way and you can end up with something that sounds actually really quite garagey. So I'm just going to move that one to the left, that one to the right, and we now get... So if I find some hats in here somewhere, and I'm just going to put them on the offbeat. So it starts sounding a lot more shuffly. Something that's quite important when you're making beats is the fact that a real drummer would never hit sort of the drums exactly the same volume every time in the same way. So something you can do to give it a bit more of a human feel is just have a little play with the velocities. So rather than having everything at 127, just vary things a little bit. Again, there's no rules, just move stuff about, but you can already hear this kind of, I mean, you can turn stuff down, start adding in some sort of quieter hits, which are going to be loud, so I'm turning them down. So we've got a nice little groove there, so what I might do is just copy it over again, and do it again. Oops, can't use the computer. Now something to keep it a bit more interesting would be just to move some of them around. So what I might do is just swap where these hits are going, so alternating them. So I don't know if you can see, I've got one there, but on the second time round I've moved it a bit later. So it might sound rubbish, but hopefully it won't. Yeah, so it's nice and shuffly, so we've got a nice kind of basis for the kit. So I'm going to stick with that. Again, what I'm going to do, I'm a bit obsessed with high passing everything and low passing it. So if I'm playing, I can obviously cut out quite a lot of the sound. So So I'm actually going to do is go with something like this. And whilst it might sound quite sort of small, once you get some other sounds on top, it'll just sort of help it cut through. So what I'm actually going to do is start using some of these sends we set up. Now on beats, it's probably you're going to be a bit less likely to use delays, but I'm definitely going to want a bit of reverb on there. So you're going to suddenly get a very spacey sound compared to the dry sound. So it's just about getting a level. And the reverb's going to sound quite clean because we've already sort of high-passed that and rolled a bit of the high end off. I mean, we've got the delays here. So there's the effects end with the pitch up, so you can kind of hear getting some quite crazy textures there. So I might actually use a bit of that pitch shift and delay on my drum beat, which is obviously what everyone does. Alright, so what I might do on top of that now is just get a bit of a heavier sounding kit in there. So again, I'm just going to use battery. I mean, you can do, I mean, all the stuff I'm doing in here, you can do in pretty much any sampler, free VST ones, you know, so it doesn't have to be anything too specific. Just anything you can play with an envelope and the pitch. I might use some of my hits from the sample CD, because at least I know they're going to kind of sound Phaeleh-y. So again, if I just loop this now, that's the beat we've got. So it's obviously quite small, we've rolled off a lot of the low end. So now if I was to put a bigger kick over the top, it should hopefully sound a bit fuller. You can kind of hear that sits quite nicely under the glitchy kick. I need to find some kind of snare. That'll do. I'm just going to go for a pretty bog standard half step beat just to start off with. And because these are the main hits, I'm actually going to leave those ones at 127, but what I might start doing is putting in some other hits at slightly lower volume. So hopefully the camera sort of picks these up. So I'm just literally just putting a few extra kicks in there, just to help kind of push the beat along. Again, you can do a similar thing with your snare as well. I'm going to go for a very cliche dubstep beat. And again, like I was saying about syncopation, I like putting a lot of hits, not on the obvious beats, because it just kind of helps stuff roll. So I'm going to keep putting some here on the, I'm not sure what you call them. I call them the E and the A, so you've got one E and a. I'm actually going to keep those rolling there. So we've got quite a good groove there. I'm just going to give it a little save. Whereas if all the velocities were 127, it's alright, but it's not really doing it for me, so I'm just going to undo those. Get the groove back a little bit. Right, I'm going to do one more thing on the drums quickly. I'm just going to do this again, just in a sampler. What I'm actually going to do here is load up some sounds off my drum synth, which isn't plugged in at the moment. This fine silver beast up there, which you probably won't be able to see because it's not plugged in. I use these hi-hats in every tune I've ever done. So what I'm going to do, like I did previously, I'm just going to make the hits a little bit shorter, if I can find them. So they almost end up a little bit more glitchy again. Again, I just don't like stuff eating sort of up space in the mix too much. All I'm going to do here, just go through a few different hits. Random, I mean, again, there's nothing too set in the way I'm doing this. I mean, you'll see in a minute, like the previous hits, what I find is more important. If I solo this, you end up with a very nasty, just sounds a bit rubbish. So what I'm actually going to do is just come in, have a play with the velocities again, just, yeah, wherever really, hope for the best. Again, I think I can pull some of those hits down a little bit. Yeah, I actually like that first bar more, so I'm just going to copy that over. Before I bring everything else in, I'm once again going to put an EQ on it, because the thing is with the high end, on a lot of monitors, you won't actually be able to hear the very, very top end. So you'll make a tune, you'll think it sounds good, and then you'll send it off for mastering should you get it released, and then you'll suddenly wonder where all the high end's gone. And quite often, a mastering engineer might have to take off a lot of the high end from things like hats and cymbals, because it's just going to be too aggressive sort of on the final mix. So to save problems like that happening, which has happened to me on a few releases, I'm just going to roll the high end off a little bit. And again, a bit of the low end as well. So instead of having a full, it's just a little bit tidier there. So hopefully, if I pull the sounds in at once, one thing I can notice is that the reverb on my first kit is a little bit aggressive, so I'm just going to sort of rein that in a little bit. Maybe pull the volume down, you know, just have a play with the level so it's sitting all right. One thing I am going to do when I work out what the snare is, I'm actually going to set that on a separate channel, just so I can get a little bit of reverb on there. Just gives it a little bit more space, and I don't know, I mean, if you're doing a sort of tear out tune or something heavy, you probably don't want this much reverb everywhere, but for something a little bit more chilled, I can't fight it. So then what you've got there, by having the layers, you've got quite a good way of bringing a tune in. You could always start with the hi-hats. So what I might do is just layer out how you might actually use this in the real world, bring in the glitch kits there, and then after 16, I'm gonna let the whole kit drop. So you end up with something where you start with the hats, could be for an intro, bringing some other noises. Oh, it helps if you put it on the bar as well. I've done something bad here and I can't work out quite what. Also make sure when you're making loops that in MIDI that they're actually the length that you want it to be, or else when you copy stuff across it all goes out of time, and that can break your head later on when you're wondering why this tune doesn't work anymore. So in theory, it should be in time now. That's a bit better. Hopefully when the kick comes in, we'll get an idea of how it's kind of progressed the beat. Snare's a little bit aggressive, so I'm just going to pull that down. And I imagine most people, like myself, just add endless channels, don't name anything. Whilst that's great when you've only got three tracks, if you end up being like 100 plus, which most of my tunes end up being, it gets a bit annoying. So it's definitely worth just labelling stuff, just so you know what you're doing, even if you spell it wrong like I do there. Main hits, hats, you know, just gives you, it just saves a bit of time. Something I also like to do, actually I'll save that for later, is I normally put things in a folder track. So I put all my beats in a folder, or my bass, or my synths, just so it's a lot quicker. So when I know I'm trying to fix certain sounds, it's a lot easier to just go in and find it and not have mess everywhere. But I'll do that once we've got some extra sounds down. Next up, I think today I'm gonna put in some lounge piano, because that's something I love doing. For most of my piano stuff, I'll always use a plugin called Lounge Lizard. I've used it for years. I think I've actually got a newer version in my inbox from them recently, but I still haven't installed it. So we've got here just a classic electric piano sound. I'm actually not going to bother finding anything too crazy, I'm just going to use this. Now this is where the sends we've set up will hopefully come into their own. Now obviously you can hear sustained notes, very short decay one, there's a bit of reverb built in onto it anyway. But what I'm actually going to do, get a bit higher, work out how to play the keyboard with my left hand. I'm going to put a bit of the reverb up. No, depends how crazy you want to go, but it's actually the delay. So this is my first delay, with the three chord delay. You can kind of hear that moving around a little bit. I mean, I could possibly turn the feedback up on that. That's a bit better. I'm going to put the other delay up as well. And you actually end up with these two delays. You've got a shorter one and a longer one. They're kind of overlapping and panning over each other. I might have been a bit aggressive here, but I'm trying to get across the effect sense. And I'm going to use that pitch one as well. So instead of this dry, we've now got this. So what we really need to do is come up with some kind of chord sequence. Again, I might have to tone down the effect sense, which I've pumped a little too aggressively for the sake of the camera, but that's better. So something on most of my music's pretty basic in terms of the sort of chord structures and things. It tends to be very kind of three or four chord sort of progressions. I mean, I'll leave it up to you to sort of pick what chord you're going to do, but I'll just do something pretty basic and a little bit cliched maybe. Yeah, that sounds good to me. That's the other thing. Don't get too lost in trying to work out what you want to do. Just get it down and you'll know soon enough if it sounds good or not. So I could try playing it, but I think I'm actually just going to sequence it in. Work out where I am. So again, like the drums, it's really important that you vary the velocities. As you can hear, if I'm... that slightly distorted the output. So what I'm going to do, and again, for something with lounge piano, it's kind of, I want it to sound live, so I'm going to turn the quantize off. So what I'm basically going to do is get the bottom note in on my sequence. Oh, it's really loud. I might make it sort of quite a slow thing. So I'm just going to get the bottom note of my chords in there. It's going to be really loud. Hold it. There we go, that's a bit better. So there's the bottom note. And I'm just going to put my chord over the top, making sure I turn it down before it comes in. And again, I don't know if you can see here, it's sometimes quite good, because when you, most people playing a keyboard won't hit the notes at the same time. So what you actually get, if I zoom in here, you get a slight delay as the fingers normally sort of go across the keyboard. So rather than it being bang on the beat, you end up with sort of almost like a sort of mini arpeggio or something. So you kind of get this spread sound. And I'm going to do the same for that here. I'm going to cheat and just grab this. Oh, no I'm not, because I hit the wrong button. That should do it. Move that up there, because it's going to be a major. I might actually throw in an extra note on top. Again, pull the velocity down. Playing again doesn't really matter, you can mess about. Oh, I've got to stop letting those loud notes go through. There we go, good enough for me. Chord sequence, it'll do its job. Yeah, hopefully it works with the drums. Naturally, I'm going to want to stick a bit of EQ on there. Again, it just really helps just taking the low end out of the way, because by the time you've got all your tracks together, if you haven't really taken care of the EQ when it comes to doing the mix down at the end of the day, it's a bit of a pain in the arse, if I'm being honest. So like, I try to kind of EQ stuff as I'm going, even if it's just basically. So I think that's kind of cool. So what I might do, when I'm making a tune, I've got a progression like that. It can work with one track. But what I'm going to do is layer that up with a pad. As well, and for that I'm going to use Alchemy. I could spend hours making a pad, but for the sake of this today, I'm just going to go and find one that sounds good. You can't really go too wrong with any of their presets. Not that I should be saying that. I spent hours and hours making my pad sounds. But I mean, the reason I like this one is because you can import your own samples into it. So I mean, one of the best pads I made from it, I think it was a melodica and a viola or something like that combined. So you've got these crazy sounds. Ah, here we go. That's a nice sounding pad. So I'm not cheating now. So yeah, it's a violin and a melodica. It's just a single note of each, but somehow we've got this quite epic sound. Now, it sounds a little bit, not boring, but it's not moving about as much as I want it to. So again, my trusty effect sense, if I come in on the... I can play with the pitch one. Put the delays up. Just get a bit more sort of interesting thing. Now what you can do, you can play, sort of move around certain things. I've been slack and I haven't set up any of my controllers for this, unfortunately. So what I might do is just quickly MIDI learn one of these. I've just put on the cutoff on the filter. I hope it's that one I'm using. So something I can do when I'm laying down the chord sequence is also play with the cutoff. What I might do is put the chords down first of all and then record some automation. So I had this chord sequence I was using, let me just mute the drums, in the piano. So what I'm going to do is play a similar thing. What I'm going to try and do is play in a different place, try different inversions. That's where you swap the order of the notes around. So if you've got the notes, my first chord's got the notes A, C and E, it's an A minor chord. So rather than playing it in the same way, I'll play it somewhere else on the keyboard, maybe spread the notes out a bit more, just so there's less conflicts in the mix down. So what I might do is play very low notes. Again, I'm just going to sequence this in because my ability to play in time died years ago. Here we go, I've got a nice low note. I'm actually going to quantize these ones just to make it a bit easier. So even if I just put a low note underneath and unsolo it. Again, it sounded a bit muddy, but we can deal with that once I've viewed it. In fact, I think that's a little bit too low. So I'm just going to pick some random notes out of the chord I was playing above it. I might actually copy the melody I was doing. Down on those. I actually want to get the C note in there because that's what's making it a minor chord. That's what's going to make everyone cry when they hear it. You don't want any of this major stuff. It's rubbish. So at the moment it's sounding a little bit messy. Again, this is hopefully where the EQ will come in. So if I just roll all of that off. So I don't really want the pad to be so audible. I don't want it to take over from the lounge piano. I just want it to add a bit of layer into it. So if I just take it out, let the lounge roll and then bring it up, listen out. You can kind of hear it's just adding a bit of subtle texture on top of the lounge piano. So what I might do now, we have this intro, I might just copy my pads back to the beginning and have the lounge come in when the beats come in. I haven't been watching my output gain, so I'm just going to pull the master down. And let's hope for the best. See how it's sounding so far. I'm actually going to stop the drums just before that. Yeah, I'm rating that. I think that'll do. Right, what next? Something I said we were going to do is just obviously play with the cutoff on the pads, which I forgot I'd mentioned. Now I've actually just set up a MIDI learn on my cutoff. Most VSTs it's pretty easy to just set things like that up. I'm actually going to record it as part of the MIDI track, but rather than putting it over the notes I've done, I'm actually going to just duplicate the track, kill the MIDI notes and record the MIDI separately, the controller data. I just find it easier if you're going to make edits later on, just to keep things a bit separate. Again, you can throw them together in a folder or group the tracks. There's different ways you can do it. So if I get this open, I'm just going to pull the cutoff, which is here, down. And hopefully, I hope this works. I record stuff in different ways, but I'm just going to filter it up. Thank you. think what I'm going to do, now I've done that, there's a bit of movement in there, as you can hear. Obviously I need to solo both channels. We end up with a quite a sort of soft sound. It's a really good way of keeping listeners interested. It's just slightly moving sort of parameters on controllers. I mean, you don't have to go sort of all out, all techer and set up epic max MSP sort of setups to move things, whilst that is awesome. You can hear it's just giving a bit of movement to the sound, and again, that's kind of everything. You need to keep listeners interested, and you know, whether they know what's keeping them focused or not doesn't really matter. It's just, you know, also keep yourself interested. You've got to listen to it for hours and hours on loop, sort of making the tunes, so there's another reason to do it. Now what I'm going to do is just copy all the sounds across for 16 bars, so we've got some kind of build up to maybe a drop of some description. What I'm actually going to do is, I think I'm going to have it drop on the 33. I might have a breakdown, I'm not sure yet, but I'm actually just going to mute off the drums, because then when it comes to the end of the loop, you're actually kind of like taking a breath. It's about phrasing. So you get this calm before the storm, if you will. It's just, you know, the dynamics, just putting the drums out for a bit, and then it'll come back in, we can drop some bass on it, okay? So, speaking of bass, I normally just use a sine wave, like a pure sine wave. People ask me what synth I use, what I do for this and that. I'll show you how I make my bass. And you can do, I'm pretty sure you can do this in Audacity and many other things. But I actually use a SoundForge, if it wants to get rid of the little egg timer. There we go. It's going to make a new file. I'm actually going to use the one I've already bounced down. But essentially what I've got here, a lot of them, insert synthesis, simple, choose a sine wave. I don't want it to pitch shift, so I just want it to generate a sort of steady tone. I'm going to tell it to do it for 10 seconds, and I guess you would have it at 1/10, 55 would be an A, I think. You have to excuse that speak, it doesn't go quite as low as this one, so if I just solo this one, which again still sounds a bit farty. Yeah, so all I end up with is a nice sine wave. I make sure at the start, starting at the zero crossing, hopefully does the same at the end. It does, thank you Sony. And I just save that and then I chuck it into a sampler. That's how I make my sub. I generate in an audio editor. I'm pretty sure you can do that in Audacity and some of the other ones. So then what I would do, if I know what I'm doing, I'll just get up a sampler. My sub's there. Seems to be a little louder on one side. I think my setup's slightly broken. So all I'm going to do is just follow the chord progression. We just had an A, a C and a D. So I'm trying to find the right notes. I'm not going to do anything too interesting. It's just going to be like that. Oh, I don't know if I can get away with going that low. Let's find out. Not the most interesting bass line, but I'm not really going for a sort of all out sort of traditional sort of emphasis on bass and drums. It's just more about the fill, so it's just more of like sort of a foundation, if you will, just to base the rest of the sort of tune on. Now what you can do is sort of layer that with some pads, doing some low end sort of things. So, you know, there's lots of options. Something I quite like doing actually, which has just come to mind, is layering my subs with some kind of cello. So I'm just going to use some bog standard sort of compact sound. I might go with the cello ensemble, sounds a bit cooler than solo. All I'm going to do is just play exactly the same notes, but just on. And another good reason to do that is, especially when you're doing a lot of low-end work with bass, is it sometimes tends to get lost. If someone's playing it on a radio or playing it on a laptop or on their phone, it'll just generally sound a bit rubbish if they can't hear the bass. I mean, that's something that happens a lot with my music. People will come and see me live and go, oh, I didn't know there was any bass to your songs, because they're just listening to it on a laptop. So I quite like just layering stuff over the top. Again, I don't want the velocities too loud. I want it to kind of sound natural, so hopefully. Enough. second. Might as well stick a bit of EQ on there, cut a bit of low sort of unwanted noise out of the way. As with everything, it's going to sound better with some reverb and delay on it, so we might as well whack some of that on there too. So if I just solo the cello. So with the sub, which I think might be the, So it's almost as though you're listening to the cello, but you're actually feeling the sub. So that's quite a nice way just to help the sort of progression, make it sound a bit better on different speaker types. So hopefully if I just bring in all my melodic elements, they should fit together nicely. Sub sounded a little bit aggressive, so I'm going to turn that down. Now we've been EQing everything so far, so which means everything kind of sits together really well. Something I really would recommend doing, if I can find the plugin, which I've moved, what's it called? It's called Spam. I totally recommend everyone getting this plugin. It's a free plugin from a company called Voxengo. It looks similar to my EQ because it's the same people. I just love sticking on the master bus just so I can see what's going on. Now obviously at the end of the day, use your ears. There's nothing you can trust more than your ears. But it saves a hell of a lot of time if you can see it as well. Now I can see here that my bass might be a little bit loud compared to everything else. So I might just pull that down a little bit. But I don't think it matters too much. But you can see there's no sort of harsh frequencies in the mid-range that might be an issue. So I'm actually just going to leave that there, then introduce my other sounds. Yeah, so we've kind of got a little loop here, nice little vibe. So what I'm going to do, I'm actually just going to throw a crash cymbal on there, because I love nothing more than a nice crash when a tune drops. Psh, just adds a bit of energy. Cymbals just cover the entire frequency range, so it's just really good as a point of impact just for emphasising things. So if I get a cymbal when that drops with the bass, it's kind of like you're sort of pulling the elastic band back and then you let it go when the sort of crash comes in. Again, I'm going to want to EQ that because I'm going to put some sends on it and I don't want the high end from the cymbal causing any sort of issues with the mix down. So I'll stick a bit of reverb on there, a bit of delay, a bit more delay, a bit more reverb and delay. I'm sure that'll sound fine. Just check it when it comes around. That's cool. But what I'm going to do is play with people's expectation. Because at the end of the day, if someone hears a reverse cymbal, they know the drop's coming. So there's nothing wrong with exploiting some cliches just to help the flow of your tune. In a way, if people kind of are expecting something and it comes in, they kind of get a greater sense of sort of enjoyment from the tune. It's like you're using years and years of conditioning. They've been listening to music their whole life. There's a reason why drum fills and snare rushes and things make you think that something's coming. It's because there normally is. So I'm going to... Basically, I've just taken the crash, I've reversed it, I've just given it a little overlap there. I might make it slightly quieter, but where I've duplicated the channel, I can actually zoom in on just the crashes if you want like that. I've made it slightly quieter, so what we'll actually get if I solo the crashes, you can kind of hear it coming a long way off. So it's kind of a bit of a cheap effect, but stuff like that just does make a difference. So if I was to play just before it drops, yeah, I think that's doing the job. I think it was a little bit loud, so I'm just going to pull the volume down slightly. Something else I've decided I want in here is just a very subtle melody. It doesn't have to be sort of something in your face. People kind of get a bit carried away with putting too many notes in and stuff. I just want something just to add another texture there. So what I'm actually going to do, I'm just going to load up sort of just a little synth sound I use a lot. Should drop in contact, I hope. Yep, so it's a very kind of plinky sound, which is what I'm known for. What I actually want is a little bit more, I should probably do this on this screen, shouldn't I? A little bit more release on the sound. Ooh. There we go, very Phaeleh-y, plinky noise. And all I'm gonna do is just find some notes that works with over the top whilst it loops. You can play anything you want, really. So I'm just going to go in and draw some notes in. No, that'll do. And then on this, I'm not sure. I'd probably spend a little bit longer coming up with stuff than this maybe, but I think it'll do. Maybe if I get a shorter loop on the go next time round, it might help. What would that be? 41. Let's just take it there now. I should change that note. Go there, there. Sure, be alright. Sound alright. Again, it's important not to have everything cranked up. Sidetracked changing the notes, but I think something like that'll do. So let's just let that roll, and it'd be rude not to put an EQ on there. So you can see here, I don't know if you can see there, I've actually got a lot of high end on this noise. Now what we're actually mainly hearing is this, so I'm actually going to roll that off just a little bit, because on a PA, if that's going at high volume, that's actually going to rip people's ears off. So you can see, just toned it down a little bit. I think we'd be a fool not to put some reverb and delay on here. So I've got to find a place in the mix where to kind of set. I don't want it to be too overpowering. Basically, they're just notes from the same key. I mean, if you're not familiar with theory and stuff, but you've got a chord sequence you like, just look at the notes you're playing in those chords, because the notes in those chords are the notes from the key, so just use them, play around the orders. Something I like doing, which for some reason I always find gets quite an emotive tone, is just dropping between the semitones. So we've got a G and an F sharp. I love that. Just seems, I don't know why, it just seems to work, and I've got a C and a B. That's about, but yeah, C, B, G, F sharp, just get these little rolls. I'm not sure why it works, but if you do that, it tends to make stuff a little bit more emo sounding, which is kind of my USP, I guess. So what I might do is just give it a little go from the start and see how it sounds, just to see where we are, because that's the thing, is sometimes you get so sucked in on working on little bits, you kind of forget about the context, the sort of bigger sort of scheme of things. So it is always good just to stop a little while and give stuff a little listen from the beginning. crash over there. Just so that sounds like a crash. Just give a little lift, hopefully. Keep an eye on the frequencies as well. So there's nothing too harsh going on in the high end, there's nothing too bad in the low end yet. I'm sure there will be when the sub drops. Melody's a bit too loud, looking at this, and also listening. So if I go and find that. So again, I'm just going to strip the drums back for the last two bars, so at the end we get a... Okay, so that we've got 16 bars there, so I'm actually going to do is just copy that across. I'm going to move the crash again as well, so you can hear, it just helps sort of add a little something to it so you know what's coming. What I'm actually going to do now is mute some of the sounds. So I'm going to take the melody out, I'm going to take the lounge piano out, and hopefully it will sound alright, and then what we're going to try and do is just come up with something else on top, just to give a bit of variation. So that could roll like that. I mean, you could add some extra melody and arpeggio. I might actually add some percussion. So I'm just going to use where are the percussion kits. I'm going to get the bongos out. I'm just going to make my loop a little bit smaller here. I'm going to mute the crash for now so it doesn't start annoying us. Let's find where the hits are. Again, like I was saying earlier, sometimes it's not about layering up the sort of the big hits. It's not about sort of emphasising those. It's sort of more about the gaps in between. So I'm not actually going to put many hits on the strongest beats. If I am, they're going to be quite quiet. Something I like doing when I'm programming stuff is working in threes. Three really is the magic number with music. So what I'm going to do is hit a note, two gaps, hit a note, two gaps, hit another one, two gaps, another one. Sort of classic sort of syncopated thing. And what I'm going to do is just have that fading off. What I might do is just use this pattern on all of them and then just vary which notes go in between. So let's find some other notes. So I'm actually going to put something on the main snare hit. So if I do that. So again, I'm just doing this very quickly. Again, the most important thing is the velocity. If you listen to it, with all the velocities up. It sounds like a computer making the music, which is obviously what's doing it. But if we put just the velocities, bearing in mind it's still quantized, but this sounds a little bit better. So I'm gonna find a little hit, just do some extra bits in between some of the notes. Again, I'm just clicking random places. If it doesn't sound good, you can change it. If it sounds good, you can keep it. Now, this is something I always do too often, is programming stuff without listening to everything else. So, fingers crossed, if I just solo the beats, and put the bongos over the top. Yeah. Again, what we probably need on there, bit of reverb. Everything needs a reverb. So something you can play with sort of maybe later on is automating some effects, so you get the old little No, I'm just going to leave it as it is. Except I'm going to put a little bit of EQ on there, because again, we don't want to get in too messy in the mix. I mean, you can see some of the low hits are going down to nearly 100 hertz, and I don't need that. That's when the bass and things like that are going to be going, so I'm just going to roll that off, find it. So that's working pretty nicely. Now something you can do before introducing a sound is if everything kind of is on or off at the start of a bar, it's sort of, I don't know, it kind of, you lose some of the subtleties of transition. So what I'm going to do here is I'm just going to mute most of the hits and just bring in the last few just before it comes in. So what you actually end up with, if I bring it back to here, bring the sounds in. So it kind of rolls into it. So I can just let that roll through. Then what I'm actually going to do is just go back to the original drop, bring everything in with all the original sounds, and I'm going to keep my bongos over the top. I should copy that again so we get the reverse crash. So hopefully it kind of lifts it. And what I might do, like I was saying previously, is introduce the sound slightly before it comes in. So here I've muted the melody. So what I'm going to do just for the last two bars is just bring it back in again, which is when the drums stop. So hopefully you'll end up with some kind of indication that it's coming again. Listening to see if something's a little bit too loud. Now I'm starting to think the lounge piano was a little bit loud in the mix, so I'm putting it down. And I'm thinking now it might be a good time just to go to the bridge. I don't think we're going to make an epically long track here. So what I'm going to do is copy the cello sound across, and I'm going to copy my pads across. So what I might do here, just re-record some of the, actually if I get the synth up so you can see what I'm talking about, is I've obviously just copied the cutoff automation here across. So what I'm actually going to do for the breakdown is just redo the automation here on the cutoff here. You can see it moving around as I turn the controller. So I'm just going to let this roll, go into the bridge, and I'm just going to record some new cutoff movement. When the second drop will be. In most cases, it's sometimes nice to switch it up so it's different to what's been going on before. I think what I'm actually gonna do is just grab everything apart from the melody, maybe think about putting something different on top. I've forgotten the crash, which is why it sounded a bit rubbish coming in. I'm gonna put the bongos in as well. So suddenly we're getting this drop into it, rather than coming out of the blue, we're playing on people's expectations again. Okay, I've decided I'm going to add another sound in here. I'm a sucker for glockenspiels, so I'm actually just going to do a very simple art part. This is just a glockenspiel from Cinematic Instruments, who I use a lot of their multi-samples. They're really, really make some really good stuff. Probably giving away far too many of my secrets there. They're definitely worth checking out. do some good stuff. So we've just got a very nice sort of sounding thing like that. So all I'm going to do, I'm just going to break up the chords I was playing before. Just go up and down like that. Again, velocity is everything. Try and alternate things. Don't have it too sort of set. It's good to have a strong note, then a weak one, medium, weaker. Just get this phrasing. It just makes it a little bit more human. No one ever will play anything exactly the same as we've previously said. So all I'm going to do, if I solo this, whoa, then we've got us a wrong note. So yeah, it's good to pay attention with what you're doing so that stuff like that doesn't happen. That all sounded very loud and aggressive to me, so I'm just going to pull all the velocities down. I'm just going to copy this pattern across and then just use it again just to follow chord sequences. So all I'm doing here is the notes A, C, and E. So notes in my chord. I think it then went to a C major, so I'm just going to change the note so it matches the chord. Then copy that across over to the D. So that should be there, I think. So in theory, so you've got a nice little pattern there. So I'm hoping, again, I've made it without listening to anything else, but I'm kind of hoping that'll work over the top. So let's see what happens. Bit of EQ. Background. Again, the drums are just going to stop here. Right, I think we're going to have to go up again. It's always good to go next level. I will stop adding stuff soon. I think all I'm going to do is just add a high string line quickly, and then I'll add a few touches, and then I might decide that the tune's pretty much there. Again, I'm just going to use a basic thing here, string ensemble, that'll do. This is a good thing with a lot of the sort of samplers and things these days, or synths like Alchemy, is they come with such massive sort of resources with them that, you know, the days of having to track down endless sample archives is sort of gone. So what I want to do is just find something just to go over the top, just to take that little bit higher, to excuse the kind of reach for the laser terminology. That's definitely a string, definitely need some more reverb, definitely need some more delay, definitely need some more delay, and definitely need some more delay, reverb, pitch shift, strangeness. So that does sound a little aggressive, so all I'm going to do is just try and find some notes that work over the top. Again, I'm just going to draw them in, because I always end up moving stuff in a play. Again, you don't want it too loud, so I'm just going to draw them in like this. Things with strings, you might want a little bit of overlap, because you kind of get that, if you think about the way people are bowing, you normally get a sustained sound, so you don't want too many gaps in between the notes. I think I was going up to an E there. Let's copy it over again. Maybe change the last note so it doesn't sound like I've just been lazy and copied and pasted everything up. So maybe go there and there, something like that. I think will probably sound all right. Ooh, turn the solo off. Just put it through a filter, so what we've got here, if I actually solo the bit I'm playing, so you can hear, just got a filter there, but I'm just going to take the resonance off a touch. There's quite a lot of energy in string sound, so I just want to kind of tone that down a little bit. Again, I might, even though I've already EQ'd it, I might put another one afterwards just to make sure there's nothing nasty hiding there. And I think that might be a nice way to... I'm now thinking that sounds quite nice, so I could put that on the second roll. Yeah, let's go crazy and put it there. And then maybe for this second 16, before we call it a day, I might grab the melody, and which I haven't named, so now I can't remember what it is, but I'm guessing it's this one. I'm going to throw that over there, and let's hope for the best on the second drop. Bit aggressive with the filtering, so I'm just going to turn the mix down so we're getting a bit more of the dry signaling. Just hope for the best and hope that it's all kind of working out. Kind of sounds in tune to me, so I think that'll do. One thing I did notice is that when it comes in, there's a few sounds at once that kind of make it almost feel like it's kind of come out of nowhere. So what I'm actually going to do is drag this higher string part back to the first part of this bridge, and then I might actually bring in the glockenspiel I used. So now I think it'll sound like this. Broken down, there's a new sound there, so it won't be so alien when it comes in a minute. Got the extra sounds in there, it's taken up a lot of the room with the sustained notes. So sort of tremolo is a really good way just to sort of bounce things around, so obviously it's not so constantly on. In terms of the melody, so I'm just going to use the second half, and hopefully that will sound alright. Yeah, I'm into that. So what I'm going to do is just copy my pads across, just as some kind of outro. Outro, all I'm going to do is just slowly mute things out, so I'm going to take the lounge away. So that's pretty much done. There is one more thing I'm going to do. So it's already getting a bit of a mess. So what I might do quickly is just take my drum sounds, move them up here, and then all I'm going to do is just move everything into a folder track. So we call that drums. So if I'm not editing the drums, I can hide that. I'm going to try and work out what's what. I think those are strings. those are strings. So I'm going to put my strings and pads and lounge in a separate folder. Let's just call that pads. I don't know what that means. And that means when I'm editing stuff, it's a lot easier to sort of move around the project. I don't know what that is. I think that's the arpeggio glockenspiel. And that was the melody, just so I can see what's going on. So I might put those two together as their melodies. It just makes it a bit easier to follow. Caps lock. Now, the last thing I'm going to add, now I'm actually going to use some hardware for this, short collar. I'm actually going to use the Nord up here. Well, me and my friends call it acid wind. It's essentially just filtered noise. So any synth can do this. I just do it in hardware because it's there. It's a lot easier. But you can hear what I've got. It's just a, just some noise. So I can feel sort of filter about. Something that really helps sort of drops and transitions, I find, is just recording a layer of that over the top, stick some delay and reverb on it, and you're onto a winner. So I'm not actually going to prepare anything. I'm just going to hit record. Actually, I should probably check that I'm on the right input on a Cubase. I am. Just turn that off. So it might sound a little bit loud as I record it, but hopefully you'll get the idea of what I'm going for. So I'm just going to literally just play with the frequency on the filter here. So we get a nice little... Just adds a little bit of interest to the ears and kind of suggests something's coming again. You can sort of do as much or as little as you want. So halfway through I could be... Oh, I need to turn the release up. Might do that one again. Bear with me. Let's just pull that back. There we go. Sounds a bit better with the release because it doesn't just die straight away. And then before the drop, I'm just going to fill her up. So I'm actually just going to do a take running through the whole tune. Then I'll just pull the volume down, put the effects sense on it. It will actually make a big difference. So I can't see what's going on. Mainly just to go over the transitions between sort of sections, just so it's not so blocky. And I think on the bridge I might do some sort of sustained noise just to sort of help sort of build it up. Just trying to keep an eye on the screen, which you can't see. And I think the bridge is coming up, so I think it's okay to be a little bit over the top on this one. Don't pull the control off though. So there's not much more to go, so just keep on the more of the same. I literally just used the Nord to do this, which is probably criminal in some people's eyes, but... It's the end that's coming up, so it's time for a bit of an epic one, I think. So hopefully, if I stick a bit of reverb on that and turn it down, it shouldn't sound too bad. So, obviously it's quite a, sort of, not the most interesting sound on its own. If I just get the effects turned on there, bit of reverb, whack it up, delay, whack it up, delay, whack it up, a bit more delay and reverb. I think you're kind of seeing my secret here. So now, some nice atmospherics, and literally every synth in the world has a noise oscillator. So I mean, I just use the hardware because it's there, but you can do it in anything, set up a controller, use your mouse, or even just draw it in on your editor. Again, because it's noise, we've got all the kind of frequencies going on. Even though I have bandpassed it, it does get a bit resonant in places. So I'm just going to roll off the very top end, give it a little high pass. Then what I need to do is just make sure it's not too overpowering in the mix. So I'm just going to check this section here. You want it to be subtle, just there in the background, just to kind of lift the song and sort of give some sort of variety to the sound. Just gonna check that's alright on this bridge section as well. Well, we can get some rain in there if we really want to, but I'll keep that back for now. There's a reason it's a cliche, and it's because it works, so don't fight the rain either. But we'll leave that for now. Hopefully the noise should just... So yeah, so whilst I don't think we've necessarily come up with something totally groundbreaking that's going to change the world, hopefully it's just given you a bit of an insight into the way I go about making tunes, starting things. Main things are just try and be a little bit organised, name your stuff, keep your sample folder organised, and just kind of, yeah, make sure you kind of EQ everything so it doesn't get too messy. Effects sends to your friends, you know, I haven't applied any inserts apart from EQs there, but it's just a really quick process just to get the ambience there. Yeah, just like, you know, it doesn't really matter what sort of DAW you're using, what synths you're using, it's just a case of if you know something and you know it well, then stick with it. I mean, I literally just use one synth these days, so I use one or two samplers, and that's it. It does me well because I know them. So yeah, if you've got stuff you like using, then stick with it. Yeah, hopefully that's sort of given you a few insights. Just check the ending. Job, wasn't it?